Call of Duty Zombies. So precious is the life of the simple survivor. He seldom finds more of it in the world of the dead. But somehow, somewhere, in the corners and cracks of the world he inhabits, life will drip down and attempt to engulf him inside it. And before it subsides, he must hurry and hide it. The clock has begun ticking, so let's go and remind him. How fast can you touch water in every zombie's map?
In part one of this series, I tried to touch water on every Call of Duty Zombies map as fast as possible from World at War to Black Ops 3. I left out all the Zombies games post BO3, as well as all the non-Treyarch Zombies games. Part 2, the part you're currently watching, will act as a direct sequel to Part 1, with the aim of rectifying that exclusion by exploring all the remaining Treyarch and non-Treyarch games I have yet to cover. Similar to Part 1, there will be a few conditions and or rules I will attempt to abide by in order to make this more interesting. The water source I find must be at least 75% water, but this only really applies in the event of no water appearing on the map, as the next best source should be at least 75% water. But of course, actual water will be preferred. And among those things that would be an alternate water source, consumables, grass, and blood won't count. Even though under certain conditions, these might contain 75% or more water, it would just make every map way too quick and repetitive and boring. And of course, just be reasonable. If it makes sense for a normal person to be able to touch a specific water source or is able to consume it, then we can safely assume that that player is indeed touching water. But also, don't take all these too seriously, we're just touching water, we're just trying to have fun out here. With all that out of the way, let's continue our deep dive into the world of water in Call of Duty Zombies. I wanted a way to incentivize further exploration on maps where water is found rather quickly. So, along with the original goal of touching water the fastest, we'll have the additional goal of trying to get the wettest on every zombies map. Other than that, I'll also cover water sources that I think are interesting besides the quickest or wettest. So don't think of this as just a touch water speedrun, but also as an exploration into the aquatic nature, or lack thereof, of every zombies map. Black Ops 4 Zombies starts us off strong with Voyage of Despair, which, in case you didn't know, takes place on the Titanic, which is a boat, which is actually a ship that so happens to be crossing the North Atlantic Ocean, an ocean that contains, yes you guessed it, icebergs. Coincidentally, right when I spawn, the Titanic crashes into one and I get my first taste of water thanks to the impact, touching water on Voyage of Despair in 1.1 seconds. One of the most deadly sources of water we'll talk about, and we're just getting started. It's a giant iceberg. You'd think bits and pieces of it would land somewhere onto my body, especially since I'm located in the forecastle. There's this broken pipe here with enough water pouring out of it that it could be used as a shower. But something was off. Where was this pipe supposed to be connected to? It broke off from where exactly? I tried to follow where it went, and it just led me to another similar pipe. Also, does it make sense for the water to pour out of this pipe like this at that angle? Wouldn't it make more sense for the water to be pouring out the other half of the pipe now that the ship is beginning to trim at the bow? Yes, I also just learned what those words mean. While I'm usually a fan of Treyarch's attention to detail, I'm a little stumped by this. Though I'm sure most people wouldn't notice stuff like this anyway, so it was probably not worth the effort to adjust. Going to the cargo hold portion of the map, you can actually go completely underwater, making the first map we covered already the wettest a person could possibly be. On the starboard wall here, we can see the damage to the ship and the source of all the water in the cargo hold, the ocean. The wall bulges in and water can be seen coming through the cracks. I found this diagram that shows the initial impact of the iceberg on the starboard side of the cargo hold, where it lines up decently with the spots in the game. You can also teleport from the cargo hold to the opposite end of the ship while still being completely submerged in water at both ends, officially making this map the wettest you can be in zombies while traveling through time and space. And in the turbine room next to it, there are machines, which I believe are engines or parts of the turbine, that have the same visual effect that the breach in the cargo hold had. I believe here, it's used to show the heat from the engines or perhaps the flooding of it. Remember that in this map, the iceberg impact has just occurred. Probably less than a few minutes have passed when compared to the timeline of the real Titanic. In real life, the Titanic was listing about 5 degrees to starboard within a few minutes of the crash. In game, it's hard to tell if it has even begun to list. So regardless, the map is stuck in a perpetual scrambling of insurance papers. BO4 has very detailed maps, so I'm excited to see what the rest of the maps have in store for us. IX, surprisingly, has no water in the starting arena area, so in order to touch water here, I have to open up one of the doors. Fortunately, it doesn't take too long, and at exactly 20 seconds, I successfully touch water on IX. It's a very poignant centerpiece of the Rod Tower entrance, so it's hard to miss. If we instead opt for the Danube Tower entrance, we can find a few streams of water dripping down from above in various places. I'm a sucker for atmosphere, and the vibes here are just immaculate. I would love to run trains with my boys here. Ah, Danu, the goddess of nature and fertility. Makes sense now. Underneath the Danu tower, we can access a flooded crypt. Laying down in it and absorbing it all in allows us to be near full wetness, from water that is probably composed of dirt, blood, human waste, and worst of all, ancient Greeks. I can't stand the smell of 3,000-year-old Greeks. That's it for IXO. At least Voyage gave us ocean water, so that's a 950. Blood of the Dead spawns us in a freezer, so if you know where to look, we can do a little hop and lobotomize ourselves with an icicle, touching water on Blood of the Dead in 1.3 seconds. This is where the Victus crew is held in some sort of cryosleep, so there's a lot of ice and water to be found. I also imagine that hanging out here, some water would at least splash onto us as the waves crash against the docks. It's a shame though, for a map that is on an island, we don't get much interaction with the water surrounding it. Though there is this tub here full of the Forbidden Fanta. Please don't drink it. And despite the skeletal remains found sunken within it, grenades seem to bounce right off the surface like it was hard ground. Not sure why that happens, but a weird interaction to discover. Blood of the Dead comes up dry with additional water sources, but don't worry, there is more maps to explore. Classified brings the level of detail up from 5 by 1000%. BO15 had one of the slowest times to touch water out of all the maps, but due to the quality increase between these two games, we can successfully touch water on Classified in about 2.7 seconds. There's puddles of water all over this spawn room, and depending on where the player spawns, we can get a faster or slower time. So I just picked this specific puddle and ran over to it. Times here wouldn't vary that much anyways. One thing to note is that the paper found within this puddle seems to be unfazed by the water. But perhaps that level of detail might be too high of a standard to expect. The day a game implements dynamic, interactive water paper physics and systems is the day I combust. Okay, I'm good. I went to check if the water source from the original 5 I found was still there, and sure enough, it was. And for those unaware, this is a firing practice area for the Winter's Howl, thus the ice on the wall and the ground. When it comes to the wettest though, it's probably these pipes here, toes dipped and face misted, really just the essentials. Spawning into Dead of the Night, there isn't much water around us, so we gotta build up a couple points. Once a couple doors are bought and the Sentinel artifact is activated, we can make our way down to shoot a few bullets into this fountain, getting some up close and personal splashing. Touching water on Dead of the Night in 1 minute and 7 seconds, our first run longer than 1 minute. But if that doesn't satisfy our thirst, we can open this door and run down the hall where we can find a spilled over vase with its water soaking into the rug. Outside in the gardens, we can find a perk machine that is actually a water fountain. I like to lay and splash around it like a frog. It's delightful. Not sure where the water comes from, but it comes. Ancient Evil is interesting because there are two water sources very close to spawn. The first one is outside past the first debris that we can clear. We're able to touch water on Ancient Evil in just 5.6 seconds. But for something a little more clear cut, we can knife a couple of zombies, gather a few points, and make our way through the other debris to find this little pond we can freely frolic around in, touching water in just 14 seconds. So overall, pretty quick times. The water here comes from that water flowing down and through the cavern walls. One of my favorite areas out of all the BO4 maps is this bathhouse area right here. This actually makes me want to take a bath, which is a feat in itself. It's also one of the more unique traps where zombies get boiled alive. Boiled undead? You can boil yourself too, but I don't advise doing that unless your layer of dirt is thick enough like mine. There's also this main pond inside the bathhouse that looks so cozy, and I hate that we can't access it. Imagine eating cereal here. Total bliss. But hopping onto this convenient Pegasus, it allows us to fly through this waterfall, showering us in water and getting us mostly, if not completely, wet. Ultimately, one of the maps with the most water to touch, next to being in the ocean. Moving on over to Alpha Omega, there is this water very close to spawn, and we are able to successfully touch water on Alpha Omega in 5.4 seconds. Though, I'm not sure where this water actually comes from. There are these barrels around the map that say clean water on them, but none can be seen leaking or spilling over anywhere. There's also this sprinkler here that is shooting water up into the air, but unfortunately, it's just out of reach. Running to the greenhouse at the back end of the map, we can find a drainage pipe that at some point recently had water flowing down through it. This is most likely rainwater, which means that the water we found earlier is also probably rainwater. Below the surface, near the generator room, there's a tunnel with a caved-in floor. In there, we'll find some of the most disgusting-looking water yet. It looks like straight
dookie.
And if we look up above, we can see pipes dripping with water. I was surprised to find this much water on this map, considering that BO2 Nuketown in the first part of the series was the only zombies map without any water. And finally, we're at the final map of Black Ops 4 Zombies, Tagdertoten. The absolute wettest map out of all the BO4 maps. There's just snow and ice everywhere. There's also lots of bodies of water to walk through, as well as swim in. The player can even freeze, which is a step above being underwater now that I think about it. I'd be surprised if there was anywhere to get dry on this map. So obviously, on this map, we touch water as soon as we spawn in. But for a non-instant time, we can hop into the water nearby and get a time of about 3 seconds. But wait, there's more. I thought up a new speedrun. It's called Ball Percent. Ball Percent is a speedrun where the player tries to snowball themselves as quickly as possible, successfully getting a face full of snowball in 11.1 seconds. And that was just my first attempt. It can definitely be improved upon. Godspeed. Wait, hold on. Let me try it again. That was a grenade. I can't think of a better example of actually touching water than picking up and throwing the snowballs on this map. It's such a silly feature for a Treyarch map, but also really cool. One of the more unique features of this map is this particular lighthouse challenge, the one where we must collect pee jars. Whenever these jars are picked up, the heavy swishing of manly piss can be heard emanating from myself, which would normally be okay if I didn't already empty my balls before this. We're supposed to take the pee jar down to the beach to empty it, but we can't make any sudden movements the entire way. If we do, this happens. Yeah, this bodily fluid is about 90% water, and it's safe to say that some of it got on us. And if we want to get even more wet, luckily, we can keep picking up jars and breaking them for more pee. So lucky. Black Ops 4 started and ended with a bang, with a few bubbles in between. The level of detail in some of these maps was insane and made each map that much more interesting to look through. Black Ops 4 Zombies had a total time of 1 minute and 43 seconds, with an average time of about 13 seconds across all of its maps. Tagdertoten had the fastest time with an instant water touch, while Dead of the Night had the slowest time at 1 minute and 7 seconds. Black Ops Cold War Zombies is up next. Will it be able to outshine BO4 in terms of water detail? Probably not, but let's check it out anyway. Spawning into Die Machine, we're stepping on snow, instantly touching water. But there's also this prominent pond of murky water in the spawn area, touching water here in 1.2 seconds. That would be the wettest we could be on this map, but I would like to argue that upon entering the Dark Aether, we are actually completely underwater. My evidence? These giant jellyfish swimming around, and whenever a zombie is killed, it flies upwards towards the sky, which is exactly what dead bodies do in the water. I mean, I wouldn't know, but don't believe me? Here's footage of a dead body in the ocean. Jellyfish fields, floating dead bodies, yep, I'm wet. Firebase Z has muddy puddles all underneath us, touching water instantly once again. The water comes in from under this wall barrier here, and if we take a look over it, we don't really see any more water. So no definitive answer on where this water comes from beyond the wall. Besides that, there's this area underneath the OPC dome that has a bit of steam coming through the pipes, as well as a few drops of water every now and then. Nothing too exciting on Firebase Z besides all these muddy puddles, which out of all the sources of water is probably the most boring. What am I using to measure that? I don't know, but I have an internal scale that would take hours to explain. Mauerdertoten is probably the only interesting map in Cold War Zombies when it comes to water. Of course, it's raining, so water touches us instantly. It's a very wet map, and we can tell by all the reflections. Look at this lovely long string of liquid water. We can see here that it comes from nowhere. Just straight ceiling water, no hole. Which I assumed was an accident due to the fact that there is actually another string of water that flows out from a pipe. I know I'm nitpicking, but that's exactly what I'm here to do. And there is yet another aquatic sin that has been committed on this map. down in the streets exists a very strange puddle of water. Normally, we can't go prone in water this deep, but for some reason, we can here. Shooting the puddle also causes no reaction and instead goes right through. Zombies also don't fall into the water when they die, and instead land on top of it like it's ice. So basically, the water here only has some properties of water. It's as if the water isn't even there. It's pretty much just a texture. I wonder if it was made this way to prevent this area from being annoying to navigate. It's a big open area, perfect for training, so I imagine this was intentional and not some weird clipping issue, considering that there are other smaller spots like it as well. Weird things are happening on Maur. Let's leave before we become weird puddles too. Finally in Forsaken, and it's raining, so water is touched instantly. The next prominent water source that isn't instant is this puddle. Touching water on Forsaken in about 6 seconds. Hey, wait, isn't this the same kind of puddle from Maur? Why does the one on Forsaken actually react to bullets? Okay, now I'm doubting that the water puddles on Maur were intentionally made that way. This game is held together by duct tape. At least we have beer here, which is about 90% water. Don't believe the beer's good? Well, there's this guy here who's clearly had so much to drink that he exploded red. Don't believe he's had too much to drink? Well, he's Russian. Black Ops Cold War Zombies has made Touch Water history by becoming the first zombies game to have instant times for every map, making it the fastest game to touch water in. I think it's partially because there's only 4 maps. Those were all the standard Cold War Zombies maps. Some might have noticed that I haven't covered the Outbreak maps, and that's because, well, I'm going to do that now. There are a total of 8 Outbreak maps, and on PC, I can't choose which map to spawn into. So that meant spending a lot of time resetting matches until I got every single map. And to top it off, the spawns within the map can be pretty random as well. So instead of trying to find the fastest time to touch water, I'm just going to highlight some interesting finds and attempt to get the wettest on every map. These maps are a bit bigger than the standard maps. So for some of them, I enlisted the help of my good friend and fellow creator, Rousefi. Together, we went into every Cold War Outbreak map in search of water. Here is what we found, in no particular order. On the Outbreak map Duga, there is a river that allows a player to fully submerge themselves into water. This phase wall tear that's here can be swum into, officially making this map the runner-up in the wettest we can be in zombies while being teleported across time and space. Kinda weird that there's more than one contestant in that contest. There's also this pool of chemicals here, though it's hard to tell what it is, so not 100% sure of its components or percentage of water. But shooting into it makes a splash like water, so it's safe to say that I would definitely dive into it. Moving on to Golova, we have yet another river to splash about in, and even though we're not really caring for speed here, for fun I still tried to touch it rather quickly. And because of its closeness to the barrier, this water became the most deadly water to touch. Diving into the depths, we can submerge ourselves all the way into water once again. This was our first interaction with the fisherman, and he will make many more reappearances due to his placement near most major water sources. Also, fishing in Call of Duty? Really? What's next? Dancing and dress up? Just kidding, I like fishing. Just don't leave tackle boxes around me. I'll eat it all. Potatoes! About 79% water. We can certainly count the outhouse special as water, just like the last time we prepared it in transit on Black Ops 2. This bathroom has a shower with dripping water, except the water is coming from the ceiling instead of the shower head. It's an easy mix-up, happens to me all the time.
Hello.
I thought that there might be something interesting on the water tower, because, well, it's a water tower. There were only tiny droplets of water dripping down. It's very easy to miss, and honestly, I expected way more water to be leaking from the tower. It was at this point, after exploring Golova, that I noticed that the quality of the environments was greatly reduced in Outbreak Zombies when compared to the standard maps and even previous games in Zombies. Which makes sense, given that these maps were made to be multiplayer maps in a fast-paced shooter game. Moving on to Collateral, we assumed it would be extremely difficult to find water on this map, given that it takes place in a desert. What caught our eye first was this huge puddle, but that was just the crude oil that was pouring out of these pipes. And crude oil can have water in it, but it's somewhere between like only 0.1 to 5% water. Which means touching this crude oil puddle gives us the lowest percentage of water out of anything touched that can have water. Luckily, like most desert levels in video games, there is a small oasis area that can be found on this map, containing a few puddles and bodies of water. I know I was just criticizing the quality of these maps, but there is a surprising detail here in this area. If we take a look at the rock wall here, I'm pretty sure we can see evidence of some sort of waterfall, or at least one that was here that has since dried up. This was refreshing to find after being disappointed with the level of detail in previous maps. Going from one of the driest maps to one of the wettest maps, Alpine drops us into a winter wonderland. Of course, there's all this snow, but let's look at another water source. A pool. table.
Come on, you suck.
Our fisherman friend here has opened up his ice hole for us to splash about in. How kind. Besides that, there's not much else. We're in the snow. It's very hard not to be wet. Sanatorium is probably the wettest non-ocean and non-Sonoya map we'll cover on the list. There's a bathhouse that seems to be undisturbed, just really the chillest area out of any of the maps we've explored so far. The same can be said for this center building that has the coolest communist pool I've ever seen. I thought it was cool that when the glass above started to break, it splashed into the water the way it should, which isn't that crazy, I know. But where else are we gonna see this interaction occur? I'm not a huge fan of the movement in this game, but I do really enjoy swimming and shooting zombies underwater. Here's a shower that has a water falling from where it should fall and not from the ceiling. And finally, there is the beach area. It's really hard to see underwater here, so I advise not spending too much time swimming around.
We can never really know what is lurking below.
We all knew that Armada was going to be the best map for water. Once again, not going for the fastest time to touch water, but if we were, this one would take the record for the fastest time to be completely submerged underwater. Hey Treyarch, there's some map in your water. I learned that this hole at the bottom of the ship that's pouring out water is called a scupper, and it's used to drain water from within the ship. The only problem is that the water kind of just pours out and falls through the surface of the water, making it look a little odd, at least to me. One last thing to mention was that diving deep into the ocean allows us to enter Davy Jones' locker. The real one, the game even tells us. Once again, we find ourselves
amongst those lurking down below.
I was most excited to hop into Zoo because it contains one of my favorite activities to do, fish shooting. Despite never playing this map before, I just knew there would be an aquarium and I must shoot at it. I was surprised to see that upon shooting the glass, water actually comes out of it, except the water splashes up in the wrong direction. Some spots of water react to being shot, while other spots do not react at all. Makes me wonder how they put this aquarium together. One thing I noticed in the polar bear exhibit was how shallow the water is here, yet this guy is still fishing here. That's why he's my goat. Other than that though, there's this beautiful fountain in the shape of your mother, and once again the zombies don't seem to even perceive the water here. And finally, we reach the final outbreak map we have left to cover, Ruka. Ruka? One of its most prominent features is this creek that splits across the entire map. You can hate all you want on open world Call of Duty Zombies experiences, but what other zombie games have crafting, guns, RPG elements, vehicles, and water? Exactly, none. Oh my god, I just hit a family. Ruka actually has a fun minigame at the trestle bridge I like to play called Catch the Semtex. I'm not very good at it, but being that close to the water at the end of my life makes it all worth it. Those were all the Cold War Outbreak maps. Special thanks again to my friend Rousefi. Definitely go check them out if you like interesting COD Zombies challenge videos. Now that we are done with all the Cold War maps, we can move on to Vanguard. The best thing about this game was the amount of maps I would have to cover compared to Cold War. It's really only 3 maps, and it starts with Duranfang, which means bad map in Spanish. Luckily for us, we spawn in snow, touching water instantly. So that's it, moving on. Just kidding, there's a bit more. One of the places we can teleport to on this map is this rooftop where it's raining, and man, is it vicious. For non-weather related water, here's this vase, making this the second time we're able to touch flower water in Zombies history. Terra Maledicta and the Archon are essentially the same map, so for our purposes, these two maps will share times. In Terra Maledicta, we initially touch water in 3 seconds flat. In the Archon, we can spawn right on top of that same area of water. If we follow this water, we'll eventually reach the edge of the map, where the water flows into the level from some unknown source. We can also teleport to a location where there are these crates of cans that when translated from German means beef and juice or something like that. But yeah, I think they were beefing with juice. Anyways, not sure if that's still a way Germans consume meat. If any of my Germans out there want to take me out for a candlelit canned beef dinner, I'm down. Not sure of the water content of it, but by the looks of it, it's safe to say that there's enough. Finishing off Vanguard with Shinonuma, we have to first build up 1000 points to clear up the stairs debris. That doesn't take too long, so once we do that, we can run outside where we can find lots of slushy mud to roll around in, touching water on this version of Shinonuma in 37 seconds. Pretty similar to the run on BO3 Shinonuma. We can't swim in this game, but we can do this cool thing where we crawl into the water just enough in a way where the game won't force us up, sort of becoming submerged underwater. I attempted to go as far as possible underwater, which is a great challenge to do on this map because we can be underwater forever. Though the zombies can push you out of the water, which is one of the worst things they could possibly ever do. Call of Duty Vanguard has an average time of 12 seconds across its few zombies maps. Duranfang and Terra Maledicta the Archon share the fastest time with an instant water touch. Shinonuma has the slowest time as it's the only map without an instant time at 37 seconds. Now that we have gone through all the Vanguard maps, we can move on to Modern Warfare 3 Zombies. Just kidding, dude. I'm not spending $70 just to touch water on a game I'll never play. But I didn't want to not cover the game. I did say every Zombies game, didn't I? Still not buying the game, so thanks to a longtime viewer and friend by the name of Thick Boy Big Smoke, they were able to provide us with some MWZ gameplay. So big shout out to them. And since this Zombies mode is a collaboration between Treyarch and Sledgehammer, it works perfectly as a transition into the non-Treyarch games. So I'm not trying to find the fastest times here, but just exploring the map similar to how we did it in Outbreak on Cold War. I'm also not too familiar with Modern Warfare Zombies, so forgive me if I don't know the name of places or things. Dolphin diving into the water. It was surprising to see the improvements on visual effects here. The bubbles when we dive in, and then the water clearing away once we emerge. It's these unobtrusive details that can add a lot to the overall experience. Similarly to Cold War, we can jump in and con a rigid hold inflatable boat while we speed up and let the water splash all around us. And I truly believe that a man is at his best floating alone, damp, on some sort of boat or raft with a gun or two and some alcoholic perk sodas. Total man bliss. The water in this game just looks good. The player actually interacts with the water in a way that makes sense, which is not always true in every game as we'll see later on. If I were to ever play this game, I'd probably be chilling like this guy. At peace, unbothered, enjoying the day at the lake, mesmerized by the waves and ripples in the water. But yeah, Modern Warfare Zombies doesn't seem so bad just based on the water, which is really the most important metric for me. Maybe I should give it another chance. Continuing the transition into the non-Treyarch games, starting off with Call of Duty Ghosts and its Extinction maps, which has hordes of alien cryptids and not zombies attacking the player. Its inclusion might be a bit controversial, but I found it too interesting not to include. Plus, it's genuinely a fun game mode. Additionally, the water in Extinction is very unique. The thing about these older games is that water placement is much more intentional. Water just couldn't be spammed all over the place to make the game look good, but it was also, at times, accidental. Which might not make any sense, but stick with me here. Point of Contact is the first Extinction map, and because it's the first Extinction map, there's a decently long intro sequence before we can get into the action. We gotta drill into this alien tumor until it pops, whilst also fighting off these annoying cryptids. We just have to wait, so there's not much we can do to speed things up here. Drilling through, we make our way to the motel, running up the stairs and down the hall to an AC unit that is leaking water, touching water on Point of Contact in 1 minute and 9 seconds. There is another one as well that leaks water, but it's a bit farther and much higher up, perfect for Chinese water torture. All the other ACs are not leaking any water. Hey HVACer watching this, do you feel represented? Beer jump scare. 100% pure emergency survival water in a can. Except the cans are empty. Or perhaps full of 100% impure non-emergency death air in a can. Tough crowd. There's also larger cans, which are just the small ones scaled up. They're also empty. There's a full six pack of unopened beers on the rooftop, and I was surprised that I was able to shoot and shatter each beer individually. Really didn't expect to be able to do that, especially because there's another six pack of beer on the same rooftop, not even 5 feet away, that does not share that same property. Infinity Ward, what the heck, man? I need my beer physics. When it comes to the wettest we can get, there's all this water on the ground here. Not sure where it comes from, it's just there. Probably where all those 100% pure emergency survival water cans were dumped. In Nightfall, we can touch water in 1.1 seconds. It's kind of hard to tell, but there's snow everywhere. But because we spawn in a tunnel, there's puddles of melting snow scattered about. In the interior portion of the map, there is an interesting detail, the fire extinguishers, which actually explode when shot. We'll see why this is of note when we explore later maps. Besides that, there's not much else. Just another snowy map with too much water and not enough time nor the bladder to consume it. We should throw a parade for May Day because it's among one of the most unique spawns where we're able to touch water in just 2.1 seconds. It's hard to see because for some reason I was able to move while the screen was still dark and fading in, but I was able to touch water during this. The boat we're on splashes water onto our face and it lands on our eyes. Unfortunately, we can't jump into the water as there are invisible walls here. There must be some gaps in the floor geometry or something. This is what I meant earlier about fire extinguishers. The ones on this map do not explode. Where's the consistency? The way this water flows down this wall does something to me that I can't quite explain. This is where I started to notice that Call of Duty Ghosts has some of the best looking water out of all the Call of Duty games. It's funny though because the water here doesn't really go anywhere. It sort of just ends and doesn't lead anywhere. Another thing is that from afar, we can really see how the water animation just gets repeated along the wall. But of the 10 people that have played this game, and out of the 4 that played this map, how many of them noticed this effect? 25% of them, because I noticed. Another example of a fire extinguisher being naughty. Oh wow, another one. And another. One more. Okay, what is going on? There is an abnormal amount of fire extinguishers in this area of the map. Just in this room, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 fire extinguishers. Not to mention, we're on a big ship. Literally just close the scuppers and let the water rise. See that? That's called a callback. It's a little trick us comedians like to use in the comedy biz. Bazinga. Moving on to the next extinction map, Awakening. We touch water in about 3 seconds. Okay, I know it's hard to see what's happening, so let me explain. Right above the spawn, there is a hole that actually has a bit of water flowing down through it. It cliffs with a boulder and follows a path along the side of the rock wall, eventually dripping off and down into nothingness. There's a bit of a fall off, and then it kind of just disappears. There's a puddle of water below it though, but I thought it might be cooler and perhaps a little bit quicker to touch the water while it's still in the air. Thankfully, this map has lower gravity, so it seems like we just barely make it to the water. If that wasn't persuasive enough, there's another source of water very close to spawn and we can stumble our way into. I mentioned how nice the water looks in this game, and this is what I mean. Just look at it. It splashes so smoothly and it shines like it has glitter. I need to drink this. I don't care if cryptids poop and pee in it, maybe that's why it looks so good. The wettest we can get is actually not this first pool of water that we see. If we follow this stream, we'll find this big waterfall area. I also found a starfish here, which I immediately shot and killed. One very interesting thing I noticed on this map was the way waterfalls are created and handled. If we walk up right below where the water falls and look up, we can see the individual textures that make up the crashing effect of the water. They're sort of just pushed through and disappear as they get closer to the player. Another thing we can see is how the textures rotate to face the player. Normally, you're not supposed to see how flat these textures are because they're aligned with the direction the player faces, but I guess they weren't programmed to rotate down towards the player if the player is below them, which is why it looks a lot nicer and normal when we look at it from the proper distance and angle. I might be wrong, but I can only assume that this was done for optimization purposes. It's a neat little trick that most might not notice, which is a good thing because it's not meant to be noticed. It's also just a smart way to do waterfalls, but this is why I love to explore the maps the way we do. We're able to appreciate all the little things that were meant to go unnoticed. This was definitely one of my most favorite details that I found while exploring these maps. Exodus is the final extinction map and we can touch a puddle of water in just 1.2 seconds. Though, there is another spawn point that is a little faster at 1 second. Overall, pretty safe to say that this is a fast one. I assume the water comes from these big tanks. There is a big rocket ready to be launched, so it might be similar to the situation I covered on Ascension in the first part of this series, where the water is stored and used for the rocket, which in real life is primarily used to suppress the sound the rocket produces but also to cool it off. There's also pipes that are found outside the main spawn room in the direction towards the rocket, but I'm not 100% sure it's for water. We can also find some bottles of water scattered about, but they don't explode when shot and look to be pretty empty, though they can be used to play a game of spin the bottle and... oh. I think we know what happens next. This eyeball on the table was actually a surprise for me, because this is something I instantly recognize as a reference to Neversoft, a company that worked on the game, but also famously created one of my favorite game series of all time, the Tony Hawk skating games. More specifically, Thug 1, Thug 2, and American Wasteland, the absolute most legendary trifecta of arcade skateboarding games. Anyways, picking up the eyeball causes a sound effect to play, which sounds like something from a Tony Hawk game. The human eye is about 98% water, and we quite literally pick this up. The only problem is that I don't see it anywhere on the HUD or in an inventory of some kind. No joke, I think we ate it. There's 3 eyes total that can be found around the map. When all are collected and activated, we're able to enter a sort of star power mode for a few minutes, which grants us every ability in the game, and when we kill a cryptid, they explode into even more eyes. I love this kind of stuff. The only other thing I found was this milk, and since it's fat-free, it's safe to say your mother won't be making a reappearance. I also happened to notice this needle on the floor next to it. Very immersive considering this map is set in California. Is that a Coke bottle? There's not much else to see in Exodus when it comes to water or any other type of liquid. It's a pretty dry map. Like the people who used to live here, we sure could use some more water. Alright, so that was all of the extinction maps from Call of Duty Ghosts. There's not a crazy amount of detail, but what we were able to find surpassed all my expectations, and there's still a lot more to explore. Extinction had a total water touch time of 1 minute and 15 seconds, and an average time of 15 seconds across all of its maps, with the fastest time of 1 second on Exodus and the slowest time of 1 minute and 9 seconds on Point of Contact. Call of Duty Advanced Warfare brings us exo-zombies, which I always thought was pretty lame until I played it recently. It's a little less lame than I originally thought, and there are a lot of aspects I enjoy about it, such as the water, and by extension, the environmental design, but mostly the water. The first exo-zombies map we'll be exploring just so happens to be the best zombies experience that pertains to the name Outbreak. Touching water on Outbreak instantly due to the rain on the map. Besides the rain, we can find water dripping from the ceiling in this room, which I'm pretty sure is also just rain. But if we fly up, we'll see that it actually doesn't connect to the outside, so in-game, the water dripping down is technically a different water source, despite it most likely leaking in from the rain. Infection is up next, and we're able to touch water very quickly. Looking back at the footage now, there's actually a puddle of water closer that I missed during recording, so we can touch water faster in 1.1 seconds. This hole of water seems to be connected to the sewer we'll see here in a second, and it's also a spot where zombies can spawn from. There's a bursting pipe that showers us with water and flows us down into the sewer, where we can dive in and under this sewer waterfall to fulfill our grandest desires. For some reason, whenever we slide in this game, the character model shows us going prone for like a quarter of a second, which normally you couldn't see in first person, but this would technically mean that if we slide here, we are completely underwater. There's also this, an alligator trap that thrashes zombies and water all around. Mess around with him and we'll find ourselves completely covered in water. Thank God. That's all that gators are capable of. If we noclip beneath the map, we can see what happens to the gator before and after it eats one of the zombies. I spent a good amount of time just watching them do this. It's funny how they just appear and reappear from everywhere. It's even possible to see two gators attack at once. We can find the gator hiding behind this wall here, ready to strike at any moment. Next up is Carrier, and it's yet another map where we have access to the ocean. Spawning in, we can touch water in... wait... I'm not sure if this counts. I mean, we die before we reach the water, but does that really make sense? Myself and most people would probably survive the fall until we land in the water. Regardless, we can safely assume that some splashings of water reach us before the game decides to end our run. Though this map has another spawn where we can touch water a lot faster anyway in just 0.8 seconds. Not as much water here as the ocean, but just enough water to feel something. There's also this guy going for a swim. It seems as though this ocean window is ready to burst open. This zombie isn't actually in the ocean. It's kind of just floating in a box. And to top it all off, this map contains one of the most interesting design rooms as it pertains to water. And in this room, if we go up to the security panel, we can activate a water jet trap. It kind of just looks like the stuff you'd see in a water park. It's funny how this just completely scrambles the zombies, but it's just a fun little boost up for the player. We can see some water beneath the glass that I'm pretty sure is supposed to be the ocean. But if we take a look underneath the map in this area, we'll see that it's just a big blue dome. It's really cool to see how they simulate the ocean on this map. Lots of neat stuff in Carrier as well, but the water in this level pales in comparison to the next. I've been very excited to cover Descent, because this map is by far my favorite zombies map when it comes to environmental design. So right off the bat, we spawn in rain, so that's instant water. We also find ourselves in the ocean yet again, but this time, if angled correctly, we can jump over the barrier and make it to the water before dying. It's a little difficult to jump over the barrier at times because the game doesn't really want us to, but it is possible. So I made a run for the ocean, completely submerging ourselves in water in 3.5 seconds. Once we descend into the rest of the map, we find many beautiful displays of H2O. I mean, just look at this. We get front row seats to the bottom of the ocean and witness all of its glory. From a manta ray, to a school of fish, and various plant life, there's a lot to see. There's even this pool fountain area that contains starfish, algae, and other sea life underneath the glass. And for the most aesthetically pleasing training room ever created in zombies, the spa. Look at all this blue and water and places to relax in. Yeah, there's a little blood and a couple of zombies, but did you check out the way the water flows down these stairs? I wonder what it would be like if I was down there. It'd probably be pretty chill. One of the first steps to the Easter egg requires us to interact with this door until it opens. It takes a very long time to depressurize and open this door, but as long as we keep holding it to the end, oh my god, I just let it go. Nah, we good. It saves our place. Once it's depressurized, we can use this power armor that's ripped straight out of Fallout to make our way through the other side of the door. The room begins to fill with water, and then we're able to walk along the ocean floor. Technically not touching water, cause we're wearing this suit to protect us from it, but I'd say it's close enough. Though, we are able to self-destruct and break out into the ocean, liquefying our fate and resting with the fishes. This is by far the most interesting water-related section of a map I've come across. Just wish there was more to do here besides high-fiving the zombie and pressing a button. Nonetheless, Descent was a very fun map to explore, and I can definitely see myself coming back to play this map more simply because of the design. ExoZombies was a breath of fresh environmental air, and I didn't expect there to be so many interesting water-related things on these maps. The total time it took to touch water on all the Advanced Warfare ExoZombie maps was about 2 seconds. The average touch water time across all the maps was only a little under 0.5 seconds. The fastest time going to Outbreak and Descent with instant water touches, and the slowest time going to Infection at 1 second. The Exo maps are fun to look at, but there's even more pretty maps in the next game that we'll be exploring. In my opinion, Infinite Warfare Zombies has the best looking maps out of any of the non-Treyarch games. They went a little more wacky with the themes in these Zombies maps, and they were able to get away with it. I think mostly because of the lore. It's like, Zombies maps are either good because they're scary and gritty, or they're colorful and silly. And Infinite Warfare maps are definitely a part of the latter. Zombies in Spaceland sucks, because I touch water in about 1 second. Other than that though, the map is great. I just like a challenge in my water from time to time, and this was really quick. I also feel like the longer a map takes to find water, the more interesting it is. Luckily, this map has more water to offer. There's this bridge near the spaceship splash ride that is dripping water underneath. I found this effect to be particularly interesting. They just did a simple squash and stretch on a PNG of what looks like a bubble and called it a day. It looks a little off up close, but that's only because the player would never see it like this when they're frantically walking past it during normal gameplay. One defining feature of this map are the water jets. They shoot up from the ground similar to the trap on Carrier in Advanced Warfare. The difference here being that after turning on the power, these jets activate on and off on their own. It also boosts the player up, but then we land hard on the way down, stunning us for a few seconds. On the upside, we can use one of the jets as a shortcut to another part of the map. Dangerous, but helpful. There's this small puck-shaped light under the ground where the water shoots out from. I found it a bit weird that there's visible geometry for this while the surrounding area is almost completely called out. That's when I realized that that's because these lights weren't originally meant for this. We can find those same puck-shaped lights in other parts of the map. On the traversal, we can actually see where the water is meant to come out of. Surprisingly, it doesn't actually come out of a puck, just 3 pipes connected to the void. Void water is the best. Going the wrong way up the water slide, we can find some more of that splashing effect similar to the kind that we saw in Extinction. And although the water doesn't look nearly as good here, the textures still move around and adjust to the player's view. It's a bit harder to notice, and we had to noclip to get here, so it's probably not that noticeable from the normal distance we'd see this water effect from. Moving on to Rave in the Redwoods. I looked everywhere in Spawn, but could not find anything. Which is surprising as we get closer to the more recent games, where we'd expect to see more usage of reflections, which are often water related. So I had to buy a door, which means being at the mercy of zombie spawns. Punching 2 zombies in their jugulars, I'm able to secure the funds required and make my way out and through the door, running into a small waterfall and touching water on Rave in the Redwoods in about 33 seconds. This water source also doubles as a trap. Infinity Ward sure seems to enjoy using water to kill zombies, because if we head to the lake, which by the way allows us to get deep into the water, especially if we slide, we can find yet another water trap. It's not a smashing stream or a shooting jet of water, but instead a school of hungry fish jumping out and taking a few bites. It's such a weird trap though, like who thought of this? Only an IW. We can do something similar here with the water, just like in Vanguard. Underwater, but not really underwater. Oh, and one last thing on this map. We can touch wieners. I tried to take some wieners to the face, but that was before I found out that they only contained about 10% water. So even if I could, it's not really worth it. What a waste of a good weenie. Shaolin Shuffle starts us off in a New York subway, which is great because I can't think of a more damp interior. So of course, we touch water quickly on Shaolin Shuffle in 1.1 seconds. Public transportation being wet and musty? I can't believe it. A lot of people ask me, hey Angel, do you have a favorite water spot in New York? And I always answer with, yeah, this leaky roof at the local punk show venue. Look, the water is so punk, it's creating a fire hazard. The sewer area on this map seems to contain the most amount of water. We can go prone into it and explore the depths, it's pretty dead down here. There's this beautiful stream of water falling onto the tracks, and this water actually comes from nothing. Just generic groundwater. Yummy. The only other place that could possibly be wetter is the strip club, but I have a 165Hz monitor, so the women just weren't spawning. Luckily for us, I can throw it back like a dump truck. We have arrived at Attack of the Radioactive Thing, which is by far the best looking Infinite Warfare map. Starting off black and white Call Me Michael Jackson, we have to make our way outside. This requires us to open up one of the doors. Once we're out, there's this puddle of water in the mud near the cars. Touching water on Attack of the Radioactive Thing in a little over 9 seconds. And here is that same source of water without the monochrome filter, just to make sure it is indeed water. Before we get to the wettest sources of water, I want to point out the skybox of the map. Skyboxes are often just real-life pictures that might be stitched together to create one larger image. And this skybox contains an actual beach with a jetty, which is not something the player would ever see. I tried to find the source of this image, but I had no luck. I even went out in the field for this one.
Wow, this is just like Attack of the Radioactive Thing.
If anyone can identify this pier, then let me know in the comments. If we look closer, we can actually see how they attempted to cover up and blend certain parts of the image. And if we look even closer, we can spot what seems to be seagulls, I think.
Henry.
Ah, the motel pool. I have a lot to say about this pool. First off, this water has almost zero interaction with the player or the world around it. No slowdown, no ripples, or even bullet splashes. Which is interesting because we can jump into the pool and hear a splashing sound that one would expect to hear when jumping into a pool of water. And what's more strange is that when we look down, we'll see that the player model takes precedence over the water. This makes it look like we're standing on top of the water when we're clearly inside of it. Because of this, I went back to check a few other maps. And yeah, it looks like this happens in pretty much every body of water in this game. I thought it had something to do with my settings, but everything is set to high or ultra. I have no idea why it's like this. But like most pools, this pool can also be used as a trap. Oh, okay, so this is how they make electrolytes. An additional oddity I noticed was this bottom last step leading into the pool. It seems to be missing. Sometimes details like scratches or cracks will be their own separate texture so that they can be applied on top of any other regular texture or object. And it looks like they forgot to place the last step and left only the wear and tear texture that would have been overlaid on top. The other stair set has this missing step, so what's a big idea here, buddy? This is a pool for dummies with zero attention to detail? Anyways, most of this stuff is not that noticeable, but once it's seen, it cannot be unseen. Making our way to the beach, where we are being charged at by a nuclear specimen, we attempt to tackle the beast head on, but we won't make it very far before succumbing to the rads and turning into a spicy broth. Also, why does this ship have so many pipes on it? Is this a boat for plumbers? Do plumbers ever get called out to boats? They must be, right? I mean, they do have a poop deck. Onwards to the final map of Infinite Warfare Zombies, the Beast from Beyond. We might notice that there is a faint fog permeating throughout the spawn area, and I'm sure that there is an argument to be made about how that's touching water, but it's teetering towards the idea that I'm always touching water due to the water molecules in the air. And honestly, that just screams boring to me. So I killed some aliens and instead opted for this body of water right outside one of the first doors from spawn. Touching water on Beast from Beyond in 41 seconds. I'm not sure why this water is here, but it seems as though it might just be leaking in from outside. This water actually responds to bullets, and it's also a trap that is similar to the pool trap in Attack of the Radioactive Thing. So now I'm questioning why that pool of water and this pool of water are inconsistent with each other despite being similar in usage. Player model is still displayed on the top of the water though. At the bottom of the pit on the way to the Tough Enough perk, we can find a bunch of rebar sticking out from under some water. Normally, this would kill the player, but I have the power of God and no clip on my side, so we're safe to take a look. If we zoom out, we'll see that this circular hole of water is actually a square tile of water, which is the easiest way to fill a pit with water. And of course, if we head to the outside section of the map, we're surrounded by snow and ice. The ultimate touch water cheat code. The only other thing I want to mention is what I found in the theater area of the map that the player can teleport to. It's just garbage juice. Seems pretty wet and creamy to me, so it's gotta be mostly water. And now that we're here, I might as well mention the last map of Infinite Warfare, and that is the self-revive room. If the player has equipped Up and Atoms, this game's equivalent of Quick Revive, when they go down, they'll spawn in the Afterlife arcade. There's not really any water in here, but if you run up to the Sea Quest arcade machine and load in, we'll be touching water in about 3 seconds. Kinda. Not sure if we can count that, but it's good enough for me. The total time to touch water on all of the Infinite Warfare Zombies maps was 1 minute and 31 seconds, with an average time of 15 seconds across all of its maps. The fastest runtime going to Zombies in Spaceland at 1 second, and the slowest time going to The Beast from Beyond at 41 seconds. We're going to do a 180 here, and finish up by diving straight into Sledgehammer's dark and gritty attempt at the Zombies game mode with World War II Zombies. The maps for this game are separated between the standard maps and the smaller survival maps, so I will be covering the standard maps first just to keep things organized. The Final Reich is the first World War II Zombies map we'll be covering, and due to the snow below our feet, it's an instant water touch. Not too exciting, but when we go for a non-instant, non-snow approach, things start to get interesting. This actually takes a while, just because we have to open the bunker door, which means stacking up a few points and turning on the power. Once we do that, we run into the command room and find a bottle of wine, shooting it open and touching about 85% water in 3 minutes and 9 seconds. We'll see similar things like this pop up again in the forthcoming maps, thanks to the increase of random items with physics. As far as getting the wettest, we can get flushed down these disposal tubes like the goldfish we are. It's a nice mixture of blood, water, mud, and other human belongings. Overall, the Final Reich is wet and cold all over, and as we'll continue to see, Sledgehammer loves their snow levels. I was excited to get to the Darkest Shore simply because I knew it would be quick. There are water puddles right where I spawn, and that pretty much makes it an instant water touch. So, for a non-instant time, I just ran to the shore, touching water in 3.2 seconds. I noticed something sort of strange with the water falling onto the submarine. At first glance, it looks like the water is coming from that burst open pipe, but in actuality, it's coming from the ceiling. I really don't know if this was intentional or not. My guess was that the stream of water needed to be the right length and still splash at the bottom. I'm thinking the devs just put the water here first and then the pipe and then forgot to or couldn't resize the water stream. So they just aligned it with the pipe and thought, good enough. And really, it is good enough. I mean, did you ever notice it? Moving on to the Shadowed Throne, and we'll find water rather quickly here as well, touching water in 1.7 seconds. So at first, it might look like it isn't water, but that looks like a water droplet texture to me. But also, if we pay close attention to the hole right above the pipe, we can see what looks like water spraying out from something out of view, which, judging by the damage, is most likely another pipe. It might be hard to see, but it's there. And it really just strengthens our case that standing under this hole will cover us in water. We can also run just a few feet away to what I think is some sort of sewer system and go crawl around with the water there. It's gross, but it gets the job done. The Frozen Dawn is ridiculous, and we spawn in snow, making this World War II Zombies map an instant water touch once again. And the reason it's ridiculous is because there is literally nothing else that isn't snow or ice on this map. I tried to find an alternative water source, but all I found was this pool of blood, which we can't count. But it's worth noting that shooting the blood and interacting with it causes effects that aren't consistent with blood. The splashes and ripples don't really make sense when shooting into a pool of blood. I mean, I wouldn't know, but I imagine since blood is thicker than water, it'd make more sense for it to look and act thicker when there's so much of it like this. So, my only conclusion is that this specific pool of blood is mostly water due to the overall environment of the map. Or, they just placed water here and changed the shader settings from a transparent aqua blue to a dark and solid red, which is most likely what happened. So, in a technical sense, we would be touching water. This becomes more apparent when proning. We're able to see a clear layer of water right below that blood layer. Hey, don't hate the player, hate the game. So, those were the standard maps of World War II Zombies. Now we're going to be covering the survival maps, which are the smaller maps of this game. But don't be fooled by their size, there's still a lot to see. Grosten House, which means big noodle in Korean, is the first of the survival maps and possibly the actual official smallest zombies map ever made. And to celebrate that prestigious title, we shoot at this vial containing the blood of Christ and touch water in 3.6 seconds. I don't drink alcohol and I don't really know anything about it, so I could be wrong, but this particular wine seems to be based on the Chateau Lafite Rothschild Chateau Lafite Rothschild. Or at least, it's the most similar wine from real life that I could find. So if you want to grab yourself the wine featured in World War II Zombies, it's going to cost you a bit over 1,500 USD. And there's only one left in stock, so hurry. I know it's not 100% water, but there really isn't anything else on this map except these potato- Wait a minute, are these the same- Yes, they are the same potatoes. Please tell me I'm not the first person to notice this, because if I am, that's really sad. Like, why is this the information that fills my brain? At least now, it's filling up yours as well. And if we take another quick look around, we'll once again find that beef in a can that was also in Vanguard. It's interesting to see how many models and textures were borrowed from this game, and there's probably many more assets that have been carried over from previous games as well. One last thing about this map is how this specific wine bottle doesn't explode when shot like the others and just bounces around. Why does it do this? Must be very aged, or tempered, or something, but what do I know? I get drunk off Capri Suns. Bodega Cervantes is a very small and very wet map, touching water instantly because it's raining. There's also mud and puddles at our feet. If we look around, the only other water-related thing is more wine. USS Mount Olympus has something fun for us. First off, it's snowing on this map and we get some sea breeze, so I consider this an instant water touch as well. But for our non-instant time, we can make our way down into the ship where we'll find a shallow body of water waiting for us. Touching water on the USS Mount Olympus in 7.8 seconds. This map's defining feature is that the ship will begin to list to the right or to the left every other round. Various parts of the map are affected by this, including this truck as it moves from side to side to block passages to other areas of the ship. And surprisingly, this also affects the water on the map. If we head back down to the pool of water and wait for the ship to begin to tilt, we can just barely catch the water rushing to the other end of the ship. It's a really neat detail that I didn't expect to see. It's also really trippy just sitting here and letting everything around me slightly rotate. Here's me before the tilt, and now here's me after the tilt. I'd say that's mostly submerged. It was also really hard to catch the water moving because it doesn't start happening until about 15 seconds into the round. And zombies spawn very close in all of these areas. Anyways, this was by far my favorite water-related detail in all of World War II Zombies. Altar of Blood is probably the second smallest map in all of Zombies, and once again, it's pretty much an instant water touch. Like I said, these guys love their snow levels. The alternative option are these drops of water dripping from the cave ceiling. Is this how they make mineral water? There's also a big hole at the back of the map that lets some snow fall in. Call of Duty World War II Zombies had a total water touch time of 5.4 seconds, and an average time of 0.6 seconds across all of its maps. The fastest times were shared with the Final Reich, the Darkest Shore, the Frozen Dawn, Bodega Cervantes, USS Mount Olympus, and Altar of Blood with an instant water touch, while Grostenhaus had the slowest time of 3 seconds. With World War II Zombies out of the way, some of you may think we have reached the end of our adventure, but have we really? World at War, Black Ops 1, Black Ops 2, Black Ops 3, Black Ops 4, Black Ops Cold War, Vanguard, Modern Warfare 3, Call of Duty Ghosts, Advanced Warfare, Infinite Warfare, and World War II Zombies. Yeah, that's all of them, I'm pretty sure. Wait a second. There's one more game that lingers in the fog. Forgotten, lost, amongst the depths where EXO and Vanguard Zombies resides. Oh yeah, Black Ops 1 on the Nintendo DS. How could we ever forget? For those unaware, there is a version of Black Ops 1 on the DS, developed by Nspace, which some may know as the developers of hit classic games such as Geist, Duke Nukem, Land of the Babes, and Mary-Kate and Ashley, Sweet 16, License to Drive, amongst a few other titles. Surprisingly, they somehow managed to port zombies over into this version of Black Ops 1, just without Keynoter Toten or 5. Instead, we get 4 whole new maps exclusive to this version of the game, which means more maps to touch water on. But because this is on the DS, I wasn't sure what to expect. Will we even find water on any of these maps? Only one way to find out. Booting up my DS and loading into House, I was struggling. This game is hard. I was not having a good time. The zombies one hit no matter what, and the controls are horrendous, which makes for possibly one of the worst zombies experiences of all time. This was also my first time ever playing this game and map, and that holds true for all of the gameplay I'll be showing for the rest of the maps. Luckily, I was able to equip the Save Slot perk early on, which is an exclusive feature to the PC port of this DS port. What does this perk do? Well, this perk works exactly like Quick Revive, except it's infinite, and I can activate it whenever, and it works across space and time. So very convenient. Every map has 2 doors we can buy. The first door is always 5,000 points, while the second door is always 10,000 points. I just had to get both doors open to be able to fully explore the map. I know these doors seem crazy expensive, but killing zombies in this game can give a lot more points here than almost any other zombies game. After a quick look around, I deduced that the first room of house has no water. Once I got 5,000 points, I opened up the next room and searched for a bit, but didn't find anything. I stared at this painting, hoping I could make out a lake or a river or something. I just wanted to at least see water, but no, all I saw was some weird homunculus creature. So I began the climb to 10,000 points. It took a very long time, but eventually I got there. Opening up the final door and going upstairs, I found nothing again. So many points and time spent just to find nothing. I checked the entire map multiple times and still could not find anything. No puddles, leaks, droplets, or creeks. This makes House the first map to not have any water, not even water we can see. Moving on to facility, I had high hopes. I mean, it's a facility, and the picture makes it look like a lab, which might have some spilled liquids or showers or something of that nature. First thing I noticed was that this map had snow out of bounds, which got me more excited to search even further. There just might be some snow making its way inside. There's a hole in the ceiling, but it must have stopped snowing right when we got here. Just bad timing, I guess. Moving into the second area, we'll start to finally enter parts of the facility. Nothing immediately sticks out, unless we count the hands I just caught. It doesn't really make sense for water to be here in this area anyways, so I just started building up to 10k points once again. I knew this next room had a high chance of having something. When I finally had enough points, I made my way in and had a look around. But once again, I was left disappointed. The best I could find was this collection of shapes in the corner. It kind of looked like a water cooler to me, but there just wasn't enough detail to really tell what it was. Regardless, there is no water on this map that we could actually touch. Though, this is the first map in this game where we can at least see a form of water. We're getting closer, and I can feel it. There are only two maps left, and I really want to touch water at least once. Doesn't matter which map. There's just no way we leave this game dry, right? Right? Time for Temple, the third exclusive Black Ops Zombies DS map. And if we look in the map description, this map is situated in a jungle. That's like the moistest place in the world sometimes. This has to be it. Is that a dock leading into murky waters? Yes, that is definitely water. I thought that I could use a grenade to create a larger splash that could potentially reach us, but it just never went off. Unfortunately, we are not able to touch this water, but we can at least admire all of its pixels. This map was a step up in difficulty, so I had some trouble getting to the next two areas. And there wasn't anything exciting to see in the first unlockable area. No liquids of any kind in sight. But wait and see what's behind this next door. Things get a bit crazy here. Crazy because once I opened it, I realized there is no water to touch again. I had just spent a superfluous amount of time playing this map, and I was starting to get dizzy from the way the game camera was moving around. I just hated how close yet so far we were to the water on this map. I know things seem really glum right now, but we still have one more map. And honestly, even if we don't find any water, I've genuinely had a decent time playing this game. Somehow, this game did a decent job at capturing the essence of Call of Duty Zombies. By making it really hard to control, I really felt like I was stumbling around in the dark, one scratch away from death. Finally, we have reached Overlook, the final map of Black Ops 1 on the DS.
Don't overlook the zombies that are coming to kill you.
I just know they were giggling in the office when they came up with that one. Anyways, Minecraft bed. This map also takes place in the snow, so I was once again hopeful to touch water. I got very excited once I opened the first door and saw the next door I could unlock. These double doors have little windows, and there's clearly light pouring in from the outside. Perhaps this map will finally allow me to go outside. And because I've been learning and mastering this game throughout all the previous maps, it was a breeze to get everything that I needed. My training arc has come to an end. It was time to see what lay beyond the final door. It took searching through every single map and room in this game to find a single source of water to touch. And now that we found it, it's everywhere and all around. It's a fitting end to this game, and we can't overlook that. So, how fast can you touch water in every zombies map? Once again, pretty fast. The total time to touch water on every map covered in this video was 6 minutes and 21 seconds. The average time across all games and maps was only 10 seconds, with Black Ops Cold War having an average of 0 seconds due to every single map being an instant water touch. They really made that game as wet as they could make it. The runner-up with the quickest times that weren't all instant was Advanced Warfare with an average water touch time of about 0.5 seconds. The slowest average time out of all the games is awarded to Extinction in Call of Duty Ghosts at 15.4 seconds, mostly due to Point of Contact, which out of all the maps in all of the games was the map with the slowest time at 1 minute and 9 seconds. 15 maps were in instant water touch, and the fastest non-instant time was a 0.8 second run in Advanced Warfare on Carrier. Out of all the main timed runs, puddles were the most common source of water, appearing in 10 different maps, while snow appeared 8 times and rain 5 times. Today, we have covered more than 50 maps across multiple Zombies games, finally concluding our exploration into water across every Call of Duty Zombies game thus far. If you enjoyed and want to see more content like this, consider subscribing. All relevant links for videos, resources, mods, music, and anything else used or mentioned in this video will be provided in the description. Special thanks again to Rousefee and Thick Boy Big Smoke for their help in making this video. You can find their links down below as well. Thank you so much for watching, and remember to stay wet.